Good morning. Welcome to Kenmore Alliance Church. My name is Adam Williams, and I'm one of the pastors here, and I'm so grateful that you've chosen to be with us this morning. It's an exciting time to be here at KAC, and we are really excited that you want to hear more about what we are about. So first things first, we are a church that's here to make disciples. That's what Jesus commanded. He said, go therefore and make disciples of all nations. And we're all about that. We want to see people making disciples that make disciples. So how do we do that? We do that through four different ways. The first way and that we desire is that you would love God in worship, word, and prayer. Worship, word, and prayer. Those three things are critical to being a disciple of Jesus. We also would desire that you would love in, that you would love those in the church, that you would love and serve the body of Christ that God has given you, whether it's here or wherever it is that you might choose to attend. And then also, we're also here to serve the world. God desires that we would be a light in the darkness, that we'd be a people that go and be the gospel everywhere we go, that people would look at us and know that we love Jesus by the way we love. And lastly, a disciple grows in holiness and humility. Our desire is that you would be a person that would not think of yourself more highly than you ought, that you would be a person that would be growing in holiness, that every single week you would look a little bit more like Jesus, and that you'd be humbling yourself in everything that you do. So how does that express itself out here at Kenmore Alliance? Well, we have a thing we call connect, grow, serve, and go. So the first things first, we want you to connect with us. We want you to come to a big group like you're here right now in Sunday morning service. We want you to connect with us, get to know us, build relationship. And then we also want you to grow with us. And what that looks like is getting involved in one of our discipleship groups, getting involved in a men's study, a women's study, or somewhere else in the church where you can learn to grow alongside with the other believers. And then we want you to be a part of serving. There are countless amounts of people that make this service happen that you're in this morning, as well as the many ministries that exist throughout the week here at Kenmore Alliance. We are desiring you to join us in that mission as well. And then we want you to be people that go, that we'd be missional people, ready to hit the ground running, encouraging each other along the way. Once again, thank you so much for joining us this morning. We hope you have a wonderful experience here at our church. And if you have any questions, do not hesitate to ask. We would love to direct you or guide you. We have a connection center that you can connect with somebody that will answer your questions and will connect us to people here so that you can join us on the mission that God has given us to reach people for the gospel. Thank you so much again, and have a wonderful service here at Kenmore Alliance.
Amen. Good morning. Oh, you can be a little bit louder through those masks. Good morning. Much better, much better. So glad you've joined us here this morning at Kenmore Alliance Church. My name is Pastor Charles, one of the members on staff here, excited to minister with you this morning. Want to take this opportunity to thank all of those online joining with us. Thank you for gathering in your living rooms, gathering in your pajamas with coffee. We are thrilled that you're here with us. We're thrilled that you continue to stay engaged with the services, just like Pastor Adam mentioned. Remember, during this time, especially as school's starting and there's still so many questions, and it seems like everything changes every 5 minutes, we've experienced that as well, and so we appreciate your understanding and compassion throughout that, but we're going to take every opportunity we can to gather and meet here in the building as we can. We've got many Bible studies that do that, social distance in the three big areas that we have: this room, the old sanctuary, the youth center, and then we've got some of our classrooms that are still larger for some other groups. So we're taking every opportunity that we can to keep people safe and still meet together. But we also, as we're approaching the fall, have lots of our ministries that took a break for the summer, restarting back up. Now, some of those, kind of like the school system, some of those are meeting full-time in person, some of those are meeting only on Zoom, and some of those are a hybrid, where they meet in person and still have a Zoom connection. So we encourage you to stay involved, stay engaged. In fact, there's a couple of those announcements we want to highlight this morning. If I can direct your attention up here, our mom's ministry is going to be starting back up this fall, and so we're calling it Moms Every Steps. This is kind of the mothers of preschoolers groups and moms of kids, but this is moms of every age, kids with every age. They're going to meet every other Wednesday. We've moved it to the evening time because that helped us with childcare. So moms, if you haven't registered, go to the website and register for that, starting up in September 23rd, every other Wednesday night. Also, speaking of our mom's ministry, if you haven't had the opportunity, or women's ministry rather, if you haven't had the opportunity to check out the women's devotionals every Monday, please check those out, especially women's ministry. Wonderful devotionals. They've been doing a great job with those video messages. Linda, thank you for yours this past week. Great devos. So women, check those out on our YouTube channel. But they're going to be gathering for a Monday night prayer meeting. The plan as of right now is to do that in the old sanctuary, and possibly as an online component to that as well. That will be Monday, September 14th. So mark your calendars for that. Next up, another opportunity for women is a D group starting up September 29th on Tuesday, two different times there. There is a workbook involved in that. You can register at our website and sign up for that women's D group. Of course, our D groups are short for discipleship group. So that's starting up. Other D group opportunities, other Bible studies. We have a precept Bible study that's going to be going through the book of Daniel, which is actually what we're going to be talking about this morning. So this is a deeper study going through that verse by verse, word by word. That will be starting up soon. We do ask that if you want to do that study, that you pay for the study book, because they go into a real in-depth study. So that will be beginning towards the end of September as well. Again, sign up at KenmoreAlliance.com. Leadership training. For all of our D groups, we've got leaders that we invest in, and Pastor Evans, our discipleship pastor, spends a lot of time with them, checking in on them, having Zoom meetings with all of our D group leaders. We're going to be continuing to invest in you. If you want some tips or tricks on just how to run a small group in your backyard or on Zoom or in your living room, this is a great opportunity to be invested in September 11th and 12th before these groups start up. Two different opportunities, Friday evening and Saturday morning. Again, register for that. That's free leadership training here from the church that we would like to invest in you as a volunteer leader. And lastly, for those of you that give regularly to your church, to the Lord, through giving here at Kenmore Alliance Church, if you'd like your envelopes for 2021, we need your information, so email us at office@kenmorealliance.com. Let Luann know in the front office your information so we can get you those envelopes. And if you need to change any of your information, you need to let us know. Last date to make changes before we order those envelopes is September 13th. However, also, we always have the online giving feature as well. You can go right to our website. We use a very secure server service called Tithely, which is a very common industry standard service, and you can give online directly to the church through that. So lots of different ways to give there. So that's all the announcements we have. Again, we're grateful for you guys joining us. We want to continue meeting. We want to continue gathering as we're blessed with that opportunity to do. So let me pray for us as we now join together in song to sing of God's goodness, to sing of his glory, and to ask God to prepare our hearts for what he has for us this morning. As we open God's word, that's a powerful thing to gather as God's people and to hear from his word and to sing his praises. It's what we were created to do. Amen. So let's bow our heads, let's quiet our hearts, let's fix the eyes of our heart on Jesus this morning and ask for his blessing. Father God, you are holy, holy, holy. You are worthy to be praised. If we didn't do it, the rocks would do it. Father, thank you for waking us up this morning. Thank you for sustaining us through the night. Forgive us for taking all of those things for granted. You're sovereign, you're holy. You made all things, you sustain all things. A billion stars, galaxies, and yet you hear my cries. What is man that you are mindful of him? Who are we that you would bend your ear, that you would inhabit the praises of your people? But you are a loving God, creator and sustainer of all things, and Father who knows what's best for us. Father, we need you. We need less of us and we need more of you. We need all of you. So, Father, by your Spirit, would you help us to be stripped of everything that gets in the way of your voice, of your perfect, loving voice, and speak to us, comfort us, meet with us, Father. Empower us to continue to live for you, to be a light in this season for you. Father, meet with us, bless us, meet with us in our homes as we're watching online. Meet with our families as we're preparing for school and different seasons with our kids. Father, we need you. Empower us, help us. We love you, Lord. We thank you for this morning. Would you have your way with us? It's in Jesus' name we all say.
Amen. Please stand and sing with us this morning.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. We are your church.
Peace. We lay down our lives for heaven.
Who you are.
I thank you that you are the God who can turn graves into gardens, that you're the God who can turn seas into highways. And we've seen your faithfulness, Father, and I pray that we would continue to trust your faithfulness going into the future. Whatever you have for us, God, I pray that we would be open to it. Would you speak to us through this service? Would you help us to live more closely to you? Help us to love as you love, to serve as you serve. Be with us this morning, Father. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Oh, children can be dismissed to kids' church, K through 5, if you would like. They're in the old sanctuary.
It's hard sometimes to do the right thing. Let's face it. Sometimes it's actually pretty hard to choose to do the right thing. You ever think about why? You ever think about why at those times when you have a decision to make, or even if there's no warning, even if it's something knee-jerk? Why in that moment do sometimes I have a hard time choosing what's right? Well, it's because my sin nature gets in the way. It's because I get in the way. Right? The heart wants what the heart wants. My sin nature is always in self-preservation mode. Protect me. Please me. Take care of me. And so what we've learned with every decision that we make, that unfortunately, there's always going to be a million other different variations or options to choose other than the one right thing. Each door, each option that we have is full of justifications, full of corners to cut, full of preferences, full of reasons that you think you deserve this or deserve that. Sometimes it's hard to choose to do the right thing. Today's book is about a guy who shows us what it actually looks like to choose to do the right things. If you have your Bibles, you can turn in the Old Testament to the book of Daniel. That's who we get to talk about today. An amazing book of stories. An amazing man. An amazing Jewish man who spends his life in captivity. His life, his ministry, in bondage, as God's people. But even in bondage, even behind enemy lines, chooses and shows us what it takes to choose to do the right thing. Father, I pray that you would speak to us through this book. I thank you for your word, and I pray that you would reveal yourself. Show us more of who you are and what you have for us through this book. Grateful that you are present here with us today, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. When I was up here a few weeks ago, kind of gave you a snapshot of where we are at as a church as we are reading through the Bible in a year. We started in the beginning, and we are, as a church, in the Bible 2020 program, going from start to finish. And so we've been trekking right along, and we're in a specific section of the Old Testament this morning, and we're actually finishing a specific section of the Old Testament this morning. Quick review, we started with creation and origin and saw what God was doing with creation, but also saw the promise and the origin of God's people as he makes a promise to a people and about their land. And so makes that promise to Abraham. And then we see conquest as they continue to search out and seek God's approval and God's inheritance, the promised land that they are to inherit. And so we see them marching through those, and we see many different battles and great stories like Joshua. And they get to their promised land, but they don't exactly carry out all the instruction God gives them to do. So we see judges, we see kings, and eventually we see even divided kingdoms to a northern kingdom and a southern kingdom. And because they don't do what God tells them to do, bad king after bad king, idol worship and false practices and false teaching, eventually God hands those kingdoms, the northern and southern kingdom, over to his enemies. In fact, in the book of Isaiah, he refers to Assyria as the rod of his wrath. Enemies of God that God himself uses to carry out his judgment to his own people. That'll keep you up at night. And we see their fall. And then through Ezra and Nehemiah, after years of captivity, we begin to see their rebuilding as they come back and rebuild the temple. And then we get a little breather in the Old Testament. We get to read some books of poetry and some cool stories and books of wisdom. And then we entered this section that, and most of that, by the way, read in chronological order. Most of it. Here and there it got changed up and the book was here and this the time was here. But mostly, up until now, we've been reading chronologically. But then all of a sudden we hit this section of the prophets, specifically the major prophets. And what that did was actually take us back in time to when the ministry of the prophets existed and when they were speaking. And those prophets were speaking during the times of the kings and the kingdoms and even throughout the fall and the rebuilding. And so we entered this section of the major prophets, right? Isaiah, Jeremiah. Jeremiah writes Lamentations. Pastor Jonathan Drake a couple weeks ago brought us a message from Ezekiel. And today, we talk about Daniel. The final book of the major prophets before we read the remainder of the Old Testament of the minor prophets. Shorter books, by the way. And this is a quick plug to the bookmarks that are available for September. If you want to grab the physical version, I believe they're available in the lobby. They will also be available online on our Facebook page and website. Help yourself to this September reading program of Bible 2020. Now, these prophets were speaking during the kings and kingdoms, sounding the alarm. Warning, warning, warning. You keep offending God. You keep not doing it God's way. You're expecting blessing by not doing it God's way. It's not going to work that way. It's going to end bad for you. And so they're not necessarily just predicting the future of the fall. These prophets are speaking the very words of God. Jeremiah himself says to the king in Jerusalem, you are going to be face to face with the king of Babylon. It's coming. Your demise is certain. And so once the northern kingdom falls to Assyria, once the southern kingdom falls to Babylon, we heard from the message with Ezekiel that there was these different waves of captives brought out of Judah, out of the southern kingdom, into captivity. And Daniel comes on the scene in the first wave of captives that's taken. Very specific group. And in Babylon, the king, King Nebuchadnezzar, had a plan. He wanted the best and the brightest. He had a recruitment program. He wanted the young, the fit, the handsome, the smart. In fact, this is exactly what he looked for. He wanted those with potential. He wanted nobility, youths without blemish. He wanted them to be handsome, of good appearance, and skillful in all wisdom, endowed with knowledge, understanding, and learning. He wanted the best and the brightest, and he wanted to train them for 3 years. For 3 years, he wanted to invest in them. What kind of bondage or captivity is that? He wanted to feed them the best foods. He wanted to train them because he wanted the best of his enemy to be the best of his people. So he even had a special diet for them. He wanted to feed them everything he was eating. Not what the peasants are eating, what the king's eating. He wants to give them his foods. Verse 5, the king assigned them a daily portion of the food that the king ate and of the wine that he drank. Now we can figure out that most of these that were selected, most of these young men were of high school and college age. I've got a couple high school young men living in my house right now, and they're fit, they're in the best shape of their life. They can eat me out of house and home and never gain an ounce. They run it off. They're talented. They've got potential. They've got dreams and aspirations. And Nebuchadnezzar says, perfect. I can take them in that moment. They're sponges. And I can rip apart everything about them that I don't want. Everything that is Jewish. Everything of their culture. Including their names. And make them who I want them to be. But all these guys see is the king's food. Can you imagine those guys gathering in the mess hall? You know, bunch of young, talented guys all just got signed up for this 3-year training program. Wow, this isn't as bad as we thought it was going to be. Check this out. They get served the best food, and all of a sudden in verse 8 we read about Daniel, and it says this, but Daniel resolved that he would not defile himself with the king's food or with the wine that he drank. Therefore he asked the chief of the eunuchs to allow him not to defile himself. Daniel resolved. Do you know what the word resolve means? It means decide in your heart. It means unmovable. It means I've written in stone, I've resolved, I've decided in my heart that this is how it's going to be. Daniel resolved, decided in his heart not to sin against the Lord, not to defile himself. Well, what would be defiling? Well, the king's food was sacrificed to Babylonian gods. The king's food disobeyed God's laws for his people with their dietary restrictions. And so Daniel resolved that he would not defile himself. This is against God's law. Well, that's okay, Daniel. They don't know that. Eat up. It's good for you. In fact, the king wants you to be strong, to be smart, to be able to get that good score on your SATs. Daniel says, I can't do this. In his own heart, he doesn't make a scene. But can you imagine how hard that would have been? In the mess hall with all the other guys, can you imagine the peer pressure? It's like today being the only one showing up at a wedding and you're the only one wearing a mask.
Are we not doing this today?
Right? He felt a little awkward, I'm sure. Can you imagine the peer pressure? Maybe even his friends going, what is Daniel doing? Right? The awkwardness, the judgment. Even the chief says, throws some guilt on him and says, when Daniel says, can you not feed me that food? I don't want to eat that. I want to try something else. Even the chief says, the king will kill me if I do that. Do you realize the spot you're putting me in with my boss? But he didn't want to forget who he was. I have a saying with my kids when I drop them off anywhere, give them rides, drop them off at school, drop them off at this hangout. if they were here, they'd tell you what that phrase is, because I say it to them all the time. And as soon as they're getting out of the car, I look at them. And I say, don't forget who you are and what you stand for. Don't forget who you are and what you stand for. Daniel knew who he was and knew what he stood for. He knew his name. Even though Nebuchadnezzar's changing his name, you're going to be called Belteshazzar now. He could see that what was being done was they're trying to steal me of my identity. This is a small little sweet step in sliding that sweet aroma food across the table that's like candy-coated death. The first of what could be a long line of compromises. Daniel resolved in his heart not to live for the pleasure of or the praise of man, but for the praise of God, an audience of one. You know what Daniel's name means? It means God is my judge. That's what his Hebrew name means. How ironic that he chose to live that way. God is my judge. That's who I answer to. That's who I'm going to live for. He didn't fear man. He feared God in that moment. Trust me, that decision he had to make the right choice was filled with other options, other compromises, other justifications. But as if he was sitting at that dining table with the Lord himself, he resolved in his heart not to sin against him. Paul says it this way in Galatians 1. If I were still trying to please man, I would not be a servant of Christ. Paul pins the two against each other. If you're going to live for man's approval, then you're disqualified to be a servant for God. Paul says, I certainly am. Peter, in the book of Acts, when he's preaching and spreading the gospel, Peter says it this way with the apostles in chapter 5. We must obey God rather than man. That's Paul, that's Peter. How about John? When John is writing his gospel in chapter 12, he describes those that were listening to the authority of Jesus. And he says, yeah, some even believed in him. Some even in their hearts knew what he was saying. Many of the authorities believed in him, but for fear of the Pharisees, they did not confess it so that they would not be put out of the synagogue. For they loved the glory that comes from man more than the glory that comes from God. It's a snare, and Daniel knew that. Daniel resolved in his heart not to defile himself, not to sin against the Lord. And because he decided that, watch this, church. God gave Daniel favor. Daniel chose to not sin against the Lord, and lo and behold, God actually blessed that. In the midst of the pressure, in the midst of all that was up against him, Daniel said to the chief, test your servants for 10 days. Just give me vegetables and water. I know they're eating all the best foods. Just let me obey my God, me and my friends. Let us do this and test us for 10 days. Do you know what happened in 10 days? They grew in wisdom. They grew in stature. Verse 17 of chapter 1, as for these four youths, Daniel and his three friends, God gave them learning and skill in all literature and wisdom. And Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. And the king spoke with them. And among all of them, none was found like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Therefore, they stood before the king. And in every matter of wisdom and understanding about which the king inquired of them, listen to this, he found them 10 times better than all of the magicians and enchanters that were in all of his kingdom. God gave Daniel favor and compassion before enemies, before his captors, because he chose to honor God. Interesting concept, church. God honors those that honor him. God honors those that honor him. Well, Daniel continues to be blessed, and he goes before the king as a dream interpreter. And he's faced with different decisions and different choices to make. And we hear about King Nebuchadnezzar having this dream, and nobody can interpret it. Nobody can tell him the meaning of it. So he gets fired up mad, so mad that he wants them all killed. I want all my interpreters, all of these special people that are around me, I want them killed. And that included Daniel and his three friends who were in the king's court. And Daniel bravely steps up and says, give me a chance to hear your dreams and interpret them. Daniel knew how God had blessed him. He knew how God had gifted him, and he actually volunteered to use his gift. Go figure. So he steps up to the plate, and the king says to Daniel, "You mean you can tell me the meaning of my dream that nobody else can?" And you know what Daniel said? He said, "Oh, absolutely." No, that's not what Daniel said. You want to hear Daniel's words? In chapter 2, verse 27, Daniel answered the king and said, "No. No, in fact, no wise man, no enchanter, no magician or astrologer can show to the king the mystery that the king has asked. But there is someone. There is a God who can. There is a God in heaven who reveals these mysteries. And it's God that will use me to do this for you, king." So he interprets the dream. The king is impressed, blesses Daniel. Because Daniel chose to use his gift. He chose to be obedient to what God had gifted him to do. And he put it into practice, blessed a pagan with it, and God continued to bless him. In fact, he goes on, and the king has a second dream. And in fact, this dream was so terrifying that it even scared Daniel. When he hears about the second dream, Daniel knows what it means, and he's dismayed, the scriptures say. And he even cries out to the king these words, "Let this be for your enemies, because this is horrific. This is going to be really hard to hear, king. So much I would rather this be for your enemies, but guess what? It's actually about you." And Daniel tells him the hard truth and the interpretation of the dream, which spoke to the king's pride and ultimately his fall. And oh, by the way, it came true. And Nebuchadnezzar was turned into a beast before he repented. So not only did Daniel choose to use his gift, but using that gift, he also chose the hard road of speaking the truth to someone that needed to hear it. Even when he was dismayed. Even when it was hard to say it. Even when it meant calling his friend out in sin. He spoke the truth. Let's face it, that's hard to do sometimes too. It's hard to choose to do the right thing. See, sometimes you just live your faith out privately, you know, when no one else is looking but God, and that shows great integrity and character. That's kind of how I envision Daniel living out his faith at that dining table. He wasn't causing a scene. He just knew, notice there's no word in that about him judging anybody else. I just know I can't do this. And so there's times where we live out our faith privately, but there's also those times that we as God's people, when we are living out our faith, when we are living out the light of the gospel, it will inevitably shine the light on the darkness of the sin of the world. And that can be awkward. That can be hard. But isn't that what Jesus told us to do? You're to be the light in the world. Don't hide that under a basket. Live it out. You're to be the salt of the earth. And guess what? Your effectiveness on others depends on your saltiness. You should taste salty to this broken world. And it matters, church, that you remain salty. Because if you lose that saltiness, how could you be made salty again? It's going to be hard. There's going to be a million other different choices you can make to justify or explain your way out of this situation. It's hard to choose to do the right thing. I'm thankful this morning that Daniel chose to speak the truth. It was uncomfortable. It requires tact and compassion. That's why Paul says in Ephesians, speak the truth in love. And the inverse is also true. The most loving thing you can do is to share the truth. Jesus says it this way, even when someone or a brother or a sister sins against you, go and rebuke him in private. Don't make a spectacle. Go and try to win your brother over in private. Paul says it again in Galatians 6, if someone is caught in any wrongdoing, you who are spiritual should restore such a person with a gentle spirit, always being ministers of reconciliation. Always being mindful of who you are apart from the grace of God. Daniel used his gift and spoke the truth. And guess what? God honored that too. God promoted and honored him with stature and influence. He was promoted again. He was promoted to the chief of the wise men, ruler of the land in chapter 2. In chapter 5, he's promoted to the third highest ruler over the land. And in chapter 6, he's promoted to leader over the whole realm. Moved up and up and up and up. Certainly not by being the popular guy, but being the obedient. Seems to me that God honors those that honor him. Well, the Babylonian captivity lasted for 70 years, and we know through this book that Daniel served and ministered under the four kings during that captivity. And we're given that timeline from when he was a teenager, a high schooler, young college age, and he's maintained and serves throughout the 70 years of the captivity so that we know he's at least in his 80s by the end of the book, by the end of some of these stories, including the one that's probably most known, where the king was planning to set Daniel over the whole kingdom and everybody around the king got jealous. And so the high officials around him sought to find a complaint against Daniel. They wanted to trap him. They didn't like that Daniel kept getting promoted. So they convinced the king to make a decree. And it was certainly a decree that the king would approve of. In fact, it was this: whoever makes petition to any god or man for 30 days, except for you, king, they should be put to death, right? King, you don't want him petitioning anybody else other than you. You're the king. The king lives forever. O king, they shall be cast into the den of the lions. The king signs the decree. He's officially trapped. King Darius signs the document and the injunction. But we read about in chapter 6, verse 10, that Daniel heard about this document. There's been a decree signed that I cannot petition anybody other than the king. Daniel, knowing this, verse 10, he had a choice to make. And certainly one of the options could have been to just quietly go into his prayer closet.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Amen. He certainly could have done it in private and quiet. But Daniel knew that that would be a compromise. Daniel knew that that would not be true to who he was. Daniel knew that that was not at all what he practiced daily and publicly. And so he continued, and it says in the scriptures, he went to his house where he had windows in his upper chamber on a balcony, so to speak, that was open towards Jerusalem, and he got down on his knees 3 times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God, which is what he had done previously every day before that. Notice, when the enemy sought after to find a complaint against Daniel to get any kind of dirt on the man, no complaint could be found about him. So much so that their only option to trap him was to make it illegal to be obedient to God. Oh, to live such a life. The only way we can get this guy is to make it illegal to obey God, because that's what he does all the time. And he prays. And they spy on him and catch him and turn him in to the king. But Daniel continued to pray and trust the Lord. Daniel continued to pray. And you know how the story goes. They report him to the king. The king loses sleep over this. He knows he's been trapped. But he signed a decree. It's law. And Daniel, at 80-something years old, we should probably change the paintings in our children's wings of all of our churches. Daniel, at 80-something years old, is thrown into the den of the lions to be torn to shreds. The king is beside himself. He goes. He doesn't get a wink of sleep. He's in horror because he loves and appreciates Daniel. He comes flying out the next morning, crying out for Daniel. And Daniel emerges, unbruised, without a scar, and says these words: "My God sent his angel and shut the lions' mouths, and they have not harmed me." And so Daniel was taken up out of the den, and no kind of harm was found on him because he trusted in his God. Yet again, Daniel choosing to obey God, and he's blessed and protected before it. God actually delivers him from the lions. Not from the den, but from the lions' mouths. Much similar to the other story in the book that you hear about Daniel's three friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. There are other names. When a golden statue is raised in the courtyard and everybody's ordered to bow before it, and they resolve in their hearts not to sin against God, and they don't. And so they are tossed, being threatened to be tossed into the furnace. And they're given one last chance. You're going to burn alive. I'm a firefighter. I've seen that. Trust me, you don't want to go that way. By choice, they say to the king and his men, "We can't do that. God will deliver us from this. But even if he doesn't, we can't do that." God doesn't deliver the three Hebrew children from the furnace. He chooses in his sovereignty to deliver them in the midst of the trial. We don't want to wait for that. We want the safety net to catch us much earlier than that. But God says, "I want to show you how powerful I am. Look in the furnace. I'm standing with you and you're unburned. Look in the lion's den and they will not harm you. Just obey me because I honor those that honor me. Will you just trust me? Do you actually believe this book? Do you believe the stories? Do you believe his word? Just trust me. I can tell the storm, the wind and the rain and the waves to stop. Trust me." Our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from this burning fiery furnace. The three friends trusted God. The psalmist writes, "When the righteous cry for help, the Lord delivers them out of all their troubles. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer." Great verse to memorize, by the way, because it's an easy reference. 2 Samuel 22:2. A lot of S's and 2's in there and T's. God chooses to honor those that honor him. It's very interesting about this book of Daniel that had Daniel, you know, just taken one bite of that food, we probably would have never heard of him. one compromise. That's not that bad. A million doors, one right door. Had he chosen any other door, maybe we don't hear this story. Maybe if he's weak before the king and he's shy and he's afraid to use his gift, because he's more wrapped and trapped in his own lack of self-confidence rather than trusting the God who raises the dead. If he was weak in his testimony to the king, maybe we never hear that story about the dreams. One of the first stories my grandmother ever taught me was Daniel interpreting the dreams of the king. Maybe if Daniel compromises in his prayer life, maybe if he shies away, we never hear the story that those of us that grew up in the church hearing every week. We never hear the story about Daniel in the lion's den. What about you? What sin is hurting your spiritual diet? Daniel knew what God's rules were, and he chose to follow them, even when it was hard, even in the pressure. But not everybody does. What sin are you choosing that is making you spiritually fat and lazy rather than blessed and honored by God? What gift are you hiding and not using? Why are you choosing to remain in your own self-doubt instead of trusting the God who created you, made you, designed you, gifted you to do great things for his kingdom? What spiritual disciplines have you compromised? What stories in your life and ministry and your family are we never going to hear about because of small compromises? Because of fear rather than faith. I want you to hear me as I close this morning, church, that I'm not preaching to you a prosperity gospel. In the life of Daniel, we see very clear that God honors those that honor him. But what does that honor look like? Well, in Daniel's own life and in this own book, we get a greater glimpse of what it is, because those were just the first six chapters of the book. Usually where people stop, because chapters 7 through 12 are a little head-scratching. You know, Daniel's such a cool dude, such a righteous dude. Ezekiel mentions him as righteous. They can't find any complaint against him. He's such a righteous guy that God shows up and gives him his own dreams that even he can't interpret. He needs the Lord's help to interpret them. And it's as if God says, Daniel, you've been such a faithful guy. I'm going to honor you with something. I'm going to honor you with some prophecy, with some visions and some dreams that to this day scholars are scratching their heads about. I'm going to clue you into something so big and so great. In fact, you can't understand the end of the book. You can't understand Revelation without the book of Daniel's dreams and Revelation. It's a flashlight for us in the book of Revelation. And it's as if God says, you're such an amazing guy, and we have such a great relationship. Come here, I'm going to clue you in on something. But that honor that he gives Daniel, it's kind of a burden for Daniel. It makes him sick to his stomach. Hearing about the decimation and desolation of his people, to hear about fall after fall after fall, it's hard truth. But ultimately, he hears about a redeemer. Do you know it's through the book of Daniel that we hear about the two archangels for the first time, Gabriel and Michael? Pretty popular characters in the Bible. First time we hear about them is in Daniel. He's clued into some great prophecy, some great truths. And it's as if God is saying this to Daniel. You've honored me, and I'm going to honor you, but your honor is much bigger than you. Daniel was a righteous guy, but God's
way of honoring Daniel was ultimately to show more of himself through Daniel. The honor is always God's. God's honor of Daniel is, I'm going to show you my plan, my story, prophecies that some of your people will see in their day, most won't, and some that even us today have yet to see. God is saying through Daniel, the story is much bigger than Daniel. God is giving us through Daniel, through the prophet Daniel, through the story of Daniel, his son. He's giving us the revelation of his son. He's showing us the Messiah's resolve to obey the Father. He's showing us Jesus' truth that he will stand for. He's showing us Jesus' deliverance in the fire, in the den. It will be my son who will come. It will be my son who will be the righteousness for many. It will be my son who will reign eternally. Daniel, thank you for being righteous. I will honor you, and the greatest honor is I will show the world my son through you. May we live to that end. Father, thank you. Thank you for Daniel. Thank you for examples of choosing to do the right thing. Forgive us for the many times we fail. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your forgiveness. Thank you for the sacrifice. Thank you for our priest. Thank you for our king. Thank you for your son, Jesus, who is the propitiation for our sins, who took our place, who took your wrath, and gives us grace and forgiveness to trust you to try another day. Father, I pray for your church. I pray that you would help us to choose righteousness. I pray that you would empower us by your Spirit to be bold enough to trust your word, to choose what is right, to speak the truth, to pray and to trust you. Father, do great things through your people. Show more of yourself through the people of the church, through the people of God, that we can know you more. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you, and thank you for coming. Have a great day.